We worship you and we bless you. We love you and we honor you, O God. This far you are Ebenezer. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. Thank you for your power. Thank you for your goodness, Lord, and your mercies, O God. And now even as we get to the word, minister to us. Open our eyes. Open our ears, O Lord. Let your word come into our hearts with transformation and with power and with miracles and all blessings. We thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Revelation 10, verse 1 to 4. Revelation 10, verse 1 to 4. The title of the message, Joy of Not Knowing. Joy of Not Knowing. I know many times we've known or we've heard and shared the beauty of knowledge. You know, there is power in knowledge. There is freedom in knowledge. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. But there is also a blessing of not knowing. A blessing of being in the dark in a certain situation or in something. Revelation 10, verse 1 to 4. I saw still another mighty angel coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was on his head. His face was like the sun, and his feet like pillars of fire. He had a little book open in his hand, and he set his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land, and cried with a loud voice as when a lion roars. When he cried out, seven thunders uttered their voices. Now when the seven thunders uttered their voices, I was about to write, but I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, seal up the things which the seven thunders uttered, and do not write them. The book of Revelation is a book of revelation. It's a book that reveals many things. John is given revelation by the Lord. So many things are revealed, things to do with future, things to do with end times. They are revealed in the book of Revelation. But here we see something concealed, not revealed. Because in this passage, John saw an angel coming down. And this angel cried with a voice like of a lion. And the Bible says, the moment he roared, then seven thunders uttered their voices. And John was about to write, because if I remind you, when the Lord appeared to John, the Revelator, there in chapter 1, he commanded or requested John to write the things he's seeing and the things that he's hearing, to write to the seven churches there at Asia Minor. And so, from that command, when he heard the thundering of these seven thunders, their voices, he was about to write. Then he received another instruction. Don't write the things you've heard. Unfortunately, today, there are many religions or many denominations, there are many cults who have stepped out to give us the mystery of these seven voices. The fact or the truth is, we never know or we don't know what these voices, you know, signified. But I know there are churches which have claimed, or there are religions which have claimed to explain the mysteries of these seven thunders. But we see that in the Bible there are things that are not revealed. The Bible says in Deuteronomy 29 and verse 29, Deuteronomy 29 verse 29, the things that are hidden belongs to God. But the things that are revealed belongs to us and to our children. Not everything we are supposed to know. Not everything we are supposed to, you know, to identify with. As long as we are in this world, we know in part and we prophesy in part. 1 Corinthians 13 and verse 9. You can never have full or total knowledge. That is simple but very significant, to accept that you don't know everything and to embrace that you can never know everything. Or in other words, some things in this life we have no clue. And you will be blessed the day you accept you can't know everything and you don't know everything. You don't have the answer to every problem. You don't have the solution to every problem. You know, you cannot solve every other issue. The day you know that, then you are blessed. Then you are free. You are liberated. You enjoy life. There is danger in thinking you know everything. Bible says in 1 Corinthians 8 and verse 1, 1 Corinthians 8 verse 1, Paul says to the Corinthian church, now concerning things offered to idols, you know everything. Then he says, knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. Then he says in verse 2, if any man thinks he knows anything, he knows nothing at all. When you think you know, you don't know. Knowledge brings pride. Knowledge brings arrogance. And in our Christian walk, we ought to walk like children. We ought to walk focusing on God, waiting on God, putting our trust in God. If anything, Jesus put it this way, verily, verily, I say to you, Matthew 18, verse 3, verily, verily, I say to you, unless you be converted and be like a little child, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. And one characteristic or one quality of the children is that children look up to their parents. Children, you know, children are ignorant. Children trust the direction and the leadership and the provision of their parents. And that is how we ought to be walking with God. But the moment you think you are old enough, you think you are self-sufficient, you think you know everything, then you don't see the need of being in the Word of God. You don't see the need of prayer, seeking God, because you think and you feel you know how to parent, you know how to do business, you know how to do ministry, you have the answers to the questions that may come in life. But the truth is that we never know enough of the Bible. We never know enough of life. Some things are concealed. And because they are hidden, that makes us to seek God more. That puts us in that position of we are childlike in our relationship with God. We can never please everybody, no, at all times. And the moment we accept that we don't know everything, that some things are concealed in life, we are humble. We have humility. We are in that position, that posture of, God, teach me. I need to know you more. I need you to direct me. I need you to order my steps. That humility leads to liberty. That humility leads to happiness. That humility leads to enjoying life. That day by day, moment by moment, I never think I know it all. I know there are things that are hidden. I know there are things that I need to seek God to be able to understand and to be able to carry on. When God created man, he put man at the Garden of Eden. And he said to man, you can enjoy of every tree in this garden, the Garden of Eden. But of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat it. You can enjoy from every other tree, but don't touch the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. What that meant, it meant that anytime Adam had a question, anytime Adam felt insufficient or inadequate, he's not sure how to carry on, whether his family or his assignment, then he would wait to consult with God at the cool of the day when God came visiting. He would inquire from God. Man at that point was dependent on God. And God didn't want man to be independent. The independence is not of God. God wanted man to live a life of relying and trusting God, fully depending on God. But then man decided he can do it alone. The Bible says when man was tempted by the serpent, when the devil came into this garden, he said to Eve, eventually to Adam, did God say, you shall not eat from this tree? And that we know the result of it, that man ate from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Man graduated from where he was and now knew good and knew evil. Man became wiser. Man became know-it-all. The result of it is that man was separated from God. The result of it is that man lost the Garden of Eden. Why? Because of going for knowledge. Going for knowing good and evil. Because of divorcing God. Because initially, man used to get direction, information, whatever he required to know, he used to depend on God. He would get answers from God. But now he has all the answers. He knows what is good. He knows what is evil. Isn't that what we feel at times when it comes to our life? I know I can, it's my life. I know how to handle money. I know how to handle friends. I know how to handle family. I know how to handle ministry or my gift. I don't need anybody to tell me. I know what is good and I know what is evil. That is what Adam and Eve, that they ate from that tree. And from that time, man was separated from God. Man was thrown away from the Garden of Eden. I want to insist on us that from the beginning, God wanted us not to know everything. He didn't want us to know all. He wanted some things to remain hidden, something to remain concealed, so that we can cultivate, we can invest in our relationship with God. Man was thrown out. Sin came into the world. What is sin? Sin is missing the mark. That's what sin is. And it is missing the mark. The moment you think you can handle things on your own, the moment you think you can do it without God. In life, brethren, we must give God room. Everything does not belong to you. There is something, there is a space, there is a room for God. And the Bible says that God said, the day you eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall die. Question, did man die that day? When you look at it physically, man didn't die that day. But I want to answer you, why man didn't die that day? God is not a liar. God is very true. If you go to 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 8, 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 8, the Bible says one day is like 1,000 years with God. And 1,000 years, it is like one day. So if you look at those mathematics, if you look at those calculations, then you discover God kept his word. God said to man, the day you eat, the day you miss the mark, the day you think you know, the day you go for knowing all, you shall die. There is no man, there is no human being who lived over one day. The person who lived the longest, Methuselah, he lived 969 days, meaning he never finished one day. Because to God, one day is like 1,000 years. 1,000 years, it's like one day. He never lived 1,000 years. He lived 969 years, not 1,000 years. So God, the word of God came true that the day you eat from this tree, that day you shall die. And so we see every person, Adam died at the age of 950 years. Nobody lived beyond 1,000 years. Nobody lived beyond one day. The word of God came true. Because the Bible says in Romans 6 and verse 23, Romans 6 verse 23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. The wages of sin is death, the gift of God is eternal life. But when you continue When you continue in the Bible, I discover there is a person who didn't die. There is one man that I see in the Bible who lived beyond their 1,000 years. His name is Enoch. In Genesis 5, Bible says, Genesis 5, verse 22 to 24, that Enoch walked with God. You see, Enoch started enjoying what Adam used to enjoy with God. He began to walk with God after birthing Methuselah. You know, when he was 65 years. Bible says, Enoch walked with God until he was not. In other words, walking with God, walking in the dictionary, the definition of walking is moving in steps. So what does it imply? It implies that every step that Enoch was taking in life, he was in consultation, he was in fellowship, he was together with God. And that is what God intended man to have in this life, walking with God. That's what Adam lost, fellowship, togetherness with God. But somebody rediscovered it. His name is Enoch. And prophetically or futuristically speaking about it, the Bible says he walked with God until at one point God said to Enoch, I think we are closer to my home than your home. And so instead of you going back, let's go to my home. And he was raptured. You know, he was caught up to heaven. God took him to heaven. So that the Bible says that he never died. Yet we know, because sin had come into the world, the wages of sin is death. But Enoch didn't die. How come? Because this is a man who chose to continue walking with God. This is a man who discovered that I'm not altogether lovely. You know, that's what we think. That's what we think. We think we are wise. We think we are beautiful, handsome. We think we are know-it-all. We think we can handle situations on our own. The moment we think like that, we think we are altogether lovely. But there is none who is altogether lovely but God and God alone. And when Enoch discovered that, he walked with God. As a result of it, he was raptured. He was taken to heaven. And today, any woman, any man who chooses to depend on God, who chooses to humble himself and discover he has no all solution, he has no all answers, he has no all knowledge, discover that some things are hidden to him, to her, and decides to trust God in this life and to depend on God, I want to tell you that prophetically, your future holds a rapture. When the trumpet shall sound, Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15 verse 51, 1 Corinthians 15, 51, and 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 13 to 18, that the trumpet will sound, and suddenly those who are alive and they are in Christ, and even those who have died and they were in Christ, suddenly we shall hear the trump of the angel and we will meet Jesus in the air. We will be changed. We will be raptured. We will go to be with the Lord in heaven. People who are walking with the Lord. That is future. But also, practically, that's prophetic. That one day, we who are depending on God as we carry on our assignments here on earth, we will be raptured one day. But also, I put it to you, that is physically you will be raptured. But also today, presently, and practically, you can be raptured emotionally. You can be raptured. Your heart can be caught up with God. Your heart can be enraptured because of your walk with God. If you learn to depend on God, if you learn morning by morning to consult God about the day's issues, about that relationship, about that challenge that is in your life, about whatever task is ahead of you, if you learn to consult with God, let me tell you what will happen. Day by day, week by week, month by month, your heart will be raptured. Moment by moment, you're going to enjoy the ecstasy, the beauty of the glorious, you know, happenings, miraculous happenings of God in your life. It happened to Enoch, it can happen to you. God can get you from one level to another. God can promote you. God can lift your life. Why? Because like Enoch, you've chosen to walk with God. Are you feeling defeated today? Are you feeling depressed where you are? Are you feeling put down? Are you feeling miserable? Could it be that the reason why you're feeling miserable with yourself or with your situation, it's because you're putting a lot of focus on yourself? It's time to get your eyes out of you and put your eyes on Jesus. If you live to please self, you'll be the most miserable person. You will be disappointed with life. I'm saying this because when you go to Hebrews 11 verse 5, the writer of Hebrews commenting about Enoch. He says, by faith, Enoch was raptured. By faith, Enoch was taken away. But before he was taken away, he had this testimony. He pleased God. The secret, the key of being raptured, of being, you know, of enjoying life, the secret is live to please God. And you, please don't. Don't live to focusing on yourself, thinking about self, and glorifying self. You're not altogether lovely. You're not that altogether. You can't handle everything. You can't lead everyone. You can't solve every problem. And that is liberation. The day you get comfortable, that people can come with problems or questions, and you can comfortably say, I don't know. I have no answer. I can't help. I can't solve that. The day you know you don't know everything, that is the day you shall be liberated. We see with Enoch, he pleased God, and by pleasing God, he was raptured. Jesus came that we may have life and have it abundantly. God wants you to be raptured. God wants you to enjoy life. And the best way is that by understanding you are not. God is I am, then I am not. If God is I am, then I am not. That's what he said to Moses. Moses said to God, if I go to Egypt and tell these people that our God has asked you, let them go. And then they ask me, what is your name? Exodus 3:14. And God said to Moses, when you go, say to them, my name is I am. The day you know who God is, the day you focus on God, the day you get to know God, that's the day you know yourself. When he knew that God is I am, then he discovered his name is I am not. God is I am, and my name is I am not. They came to John the Baptist, and I'm finishing now, in John chapter 1, verse 19 to 23. John chapter 1, verse 19 to 23. John is baptizing people at River Jordan. And the Levites, the chief priests, now they came to John, sent by the Pharisees. Say to John, who are you? Who do you make yourself to be? Who are you? Are you Elijah? Are you Jeremiah? Are you that old prophet who was promised in Deuteronomy 18:18? Who are you? They asked John the Baptist. He said, I am not. And that's who we are. The day we discover we are not, that's the day we are free. That's the day we are liberated. John the Baptist said, I am not. I am not Elijah. I am not Jeremiah. I am not that prophet. But particularly he said, I am not the Christ. I am not the Christ. I am not the answer to the world. I am not the savior of the world. He said, I am not. And who do you make yourself to be? And he gave his identity. He gave his definition. He said, I am a voice. So next time people ask you, who are you? Don't say, I'm a driver. You're not a driver. You're not a wife. You're not a husband. You're not a pastor. You're not a director or an MD. Hello. You're not a businessman or a businesswoman. No. Primarily, you may be a teacher, but that is secondarily. Secondarily, you're a teacher. You know, you're a makanga. That's secondary. But primarily, I'm just a voice. I'm just a voice. The rest of the things, that's what I do. I'm a driver. That's what I do. But who I am? I am a voice telling people that Jesus is Lord. I am a voice wherever I go, whatever I do, I am a voice showing people that I am not, he is I am. I am leading people to Christ. So the day you understand that you are not the answer, that is the day you are free. That's the day you are liberated. May the Lord bless us so much, and let's make it comfortable for us. Let's be at peace with it, that I don't know everything. I am not the Christ. He is the Christ. I have one ministry, and my ministry is I'm a voice in the wilderness. Prepare ye the way for the Lord. Jesus is the answer. When he opens a door, nobody can shut it. When he shuts a door, nobody can open. That which he has blessed, nobody can curse. And that which he has cursed, nobody can bless. So I want to encourage you. Choose Jesus. Let Jesus be on your side. You and Christ, you are always the majority. You are unformidable. You are unbogable, they say. You can never be defeated. The moment Christ is on your side, we are just a voice. We can't know everything, but we know him who knows everything. Praise the Lord. Shall we pray?